Okay, folks, welcome back. Ladies and gentlemen, chefs, we're just about to start our second Seafish Masterclass. So welcome back, everyone. And can I please welcome to the stage again the chairman of the Master Chefs of Great Britain, George McIver.
Well done, Ben. You got it out that time. He's doing well there, Ben, isn't he? Aye. Straight from the barbecue kitchen. So, wasn't that marvellous? Stephen and Derek. Give them a great big round of applause again. I think they were just brilliant. Aye. And Stuart did a great job there on his filleting techniques, so that was rather special. So I hope you all enjoyed it. Did you all, some of you all manage to get through next door to the green sheds? See what's happening through there? Plenty of samples, sweet up. I'll only end up in the boot of my car. So, here we go. So, next up on stage from the 2-Michelin-star restaurant Andrew Fairley, we are very honoured to have today from the Glen Eagles Hotel, indeed, who are huge supporters of the Master Chefs of Great Britain, and supporters like Glen Eagles, all organisations such as ours would struggle. We need the support hugely, but Glen Eagles also needs all of you boys and girls to engage and want to work there and be cooks and chefs and just crack on in this wonderful industry we've got. So without further ado, I would like to welcome on stage Russell Plowman and Cece. Big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Could have been worse, Russell. Could have been the Bay City Rollers. But there you
could
go.
Could have been.
Welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here. Nice to see everybody. Hope you enjoyed Steve's demo. I'm doing less fish than Steve, thankfully. But it's great to be here with Connor. Connor's been with us in the restaurant for 3 months and is a shining example of students coming through. And we'll talk about Connor a little bit more shortly. But today I'm going to be cooking what's revered as the king of the sea, a wild turbot. So I've got a lovely example here. We're going to be cooking a tronçon, which is a French term for a steak. So that's going to be split down the spine and cut across ways. You can do that on a flatfish, turbot or halibut, it can work well as well. But with it being a steak and cooked on the bone, it's a meaty sort of texture that you're looking for, and turbot really lends itself well to that. So,
your view is the king of fish, turbot?
Yes, when it comes into the kitchen, from time to time, you know, it's an absolute joy to work with this produce. So, yeah, it's definitely up there as one of the best fish in the sea.
I mean, I watched the boss do it. He made a great job of it, too.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I hope I do it justice as well. So, looking at the qualities of the fish, we're looking at firmness to touch, fresh sea slime. Actually, working with the fish, I've already washed the sea slime off, so it's easier to handle. It's not going to move on my chopping board. Fresh gills in there, and nice eyes. Nice bright eyes, and as Stephen said earlier, not to smell of fish, but to smell of the sea. So I'm going to start by taking it down. I'm going to put some cloths on first. Some water.
So is the tronçon a cut that you use in restaurant Andrew Fairley? You sell it for one or two people? Or
normally for one. So we cut a steak and... we would just serve that for one person. Sorry. So the first thing I'm going to do with the preparation of fish is give it a haircut. So I'm going to take its fins off, okay? So nice sharp scissors. And we just go on the tail. And I just want to really do that to focus on the main fillets of the fish. And so nothing sort of gets entangled or gets in the way. We're going to be serving this dish today with some Shetland mussels, rope grown. They've picked out some nice plump mussels. And we're going to be making a sauce with the mussels as well. So the mussels are going to be steamed off in some white wine, and the juice that's going to be collected from that, we are going to pass through a fine chamois, reduce it down to concentrate the flavour. I've also brought some turbot stock with me. So it's a really lovely, full-flavoured, gelatinous stock made from the bones, the head of the turbot as well. And then that's going to be finished with some cream. So we're trying to utilise as much of the fish as possible. So now it's got its hair cut. We're going to then take the head off the fish. So let's just take that through. Just come in behind the gill. And just a nice, clean, straight cut through. And as I say, the heads can be used as part of the stock. If we clean out the eyeballs itself and take the gills out, we'd normally, with the turbot stock, degorge the carcass overnight in cold running water and then bring it up slowly with some white vegetables, some aromats in there, and just cook it out for sort of 20 to 30 minutes. So the turbot's got inside it roe, or its eggs. So it's just on one side of the fillet there. So you just see in the pocket. I'm just going to use my thumb and forefinger and just try and gently tease it out in between the fillets. Some of the bigger turbots, the roes are quite large, and that's also a secondary cut that we can use from the fish.
Because you get huge turbot, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, they can go up to sort of 10 to 12 kilo, you know, I mean, immense. You'd be holding it up.
Big beasties.
But, this is a nice size to work with, and you get a good size, sort of one person portion from this.
So everybody in the kitchen would get a chance at fishmongery and...
Absolutely, at some stage of their career at Restaurant Andrew Fairley, we do still, I mean, it's less popular in the industry these days, but you do still see the whole beast coming into the kitchen on a daily basis, live shellfish and whole fish. So the roes have been removed now. Inside the turbot, just to demonstrate, if you can see, it's like a collarbone, which is like quite a stiff piece of cartilage, which I'm going to cut and remove, and that will help me take the tronçon out later. So I'm just going to cut either side of that. Take a smaller knife and come behind it. It's almost like the wishbone of a chicken. It's just that little collarbone there, but if you take the turbot down before, it won't be so clean to cut the steaks afterwards. If you should just give that a wash and a wipe for me, please, Connor.
Oui.
So the turbot, flat fish, four fillets. I've got larger fillets on the right-hand side, and smaller on the left. I'm going to come down. There's almost a line through the middle that you can see, which is the center of the fish. I'm going to come either side of that with a sharp boning knife to just expose those top fillets.
Okay.
straight down the back. And the other side of the backbone, again, just follow that down. We got hot soapy water up here. I think some brought some. Yeah, just there. Yeah, cool. And we're going to repeat the process on the other side. Okay, so we've made two large cuts down to the bone on both sides. Next, I'm going to sort of fold the fish in half, and it just shows you the end of the fillet. We're going to cut that off with a pair of scissors. Can everyone see that? All good?
Everybody got that?
And this is like the skirt of the turbot. And these skirts, again, it's very rarely used in today's kitchens, but these can be poached. And inside each cavity, there's little fingers of turbot that are really lovely. And
this one, I don't know, have you dined in Fallow in London? I was just speaking about it
earlier. Yeah, I had. I haven't myself.
The guy down there. But they're just fascinating. They tend to use everything that no one else will use. Mm-hmm. And the biggest selling dish on his menu is like cod heads. But like everything else he uses, it's just fascinating. And of course, with the real skillers too.
Yeah. It's having that knowledge that you can use different parts of the beast, you know?
And fish sales in the restaurant, how would that equate to meat?
Well, we use on our tasting menu, three dishes of eight courses are fish or seafood. So the a la carte has two out of five main courses fish with some shellfish as an accompaniment. And starters, you know, our best-selling... Yeah. Is the smoked lobster, which is signature of the restaurant, the dish.
Andrew's famous lobster is still the biggest seller.
It's the star of the show, yeah. Wow. So it's a full-time dish that's on the a la carte and the tasting menu every night of the week.
Well, no, any time, I mean, so many people have that.
Absolutely.
Have that dish. So how many of the audience have dined in restaurant Andrew Fairley? Hands up. Hands up. That's no bad. Hands up. What did you say? About 10. Right, you need to start saving up then.
So with the fillets now I'm going to expose the fillet just slightly, just coming underneath it, and that will just help with the cut through the bone. So either side, just with a sharp boning knife, just underneath, along the breastplate. Turn the fish over and repeat the process. So almost as if you're taking the fillet off the bone, but you're just giving it a little score just to help it. So our next preparation is going to be to come through those cuts with a sharp pair of scissors. And you can hear there's little to no resistance. It's just going nicely back through the backbone. A little bit of force towards the top where the bones are thicker. There's our one fillet of turbot there.
So what weight was the turbot we started there approximately?
This turbot was just over 3 kilo.
Over George, 3 kilo. Yeah, and how many portions would you hope to take out of that?
Probably something like this, or probably five
decent portions, yeah.
You're looking at turbots, probably one of the most expensive fishes. I was talking about cost before. So you're looking at maybe £7 to £8 minimum a portion just for the fish.
Just to put it on the plate, yeah.
Fish itself. Just come through with a knife.
And it is one of those huge things when a product is as expensive as this would appear to be, the cooking of it, to take something that expensive and cook it perfectly. Because if it's knackered, it's an expensive mistake, isn't it?
Absolutely.
CC.
Very expensive mistake.
Yeah. Top loon from Mauritia.
So again, that backbone there, you can use that. That would be great for cleaning out the sort of the gunk out there, but that would be great for stock as well.
Looks beautiful.
So we have our fillet of turbot. And to cut the tronçon, I was saying about portion-wise, we're going to just cut straight through. So it's like a T-bone of a steak, you know? That's our tronçon there. So it's just one small backbone going through, and then a nice thick fillet either side of that. Just pop that on a board. We got a board or something. I'll just pop that down there for now. That's awesome.
No.
Again, that's even better.
That looks absolutely stunning.
And then portion for me, one more, two, and on the other side, maybe 3 fillets. So I'll save that down there for George's tea later. And
looking good so far. Derek, give me the.
We're going to cook that nice prime
monk
piece
cheeks,
there.
So.
If I can just pop that on the back, wash my hands.
So this young man's been with you for 7 months.
Yeah, that's right. Well, Connor's been with us full-time for the last 3 to 4 months.
Okay.
First contacted the restaurant and Chef Stevie beginning of last year, Connor?
November of last year. November. Not last year. Year before.
Year before. And came and did a work experience.
I did a week stage around Easter. So it was just kind of spend some time in the restaurant and see how I like it.
Perfect.
And eventually that led to a bit more over time.
Yeah.
So I went to Kinloch Lodge and I was doing college and I had a work job outside of college. But I went to Kinloch Lodge for a stage and I phoned Stevie to kind of ask his thoughts about maybe leaving college and going full time at Kinloch Lodge. And he offered me an opportunity. He said, come down here, do a week experience. We'll see how you get on, and it could possibly lead to something else. So I did that, and eventually, 2 weeks after my 17th birthday, I moved down to begin my job at restaurant Andrew Fairley's.
Isn't that amazing? And that is open to every student here, is actually taking the balls, phoning somebody up, and really saying, I want a job, I want to work for you. Because that's how I started my career. I plagued the backside off the chef until he gave me a job.
You should have heard my voice when I gave Stevie a call.
Yeah.
I was like, hi, chef.
But I'm still like that when I speak to him.
There's always doors open and not too many closed in the industry. You know, we're looking for more and more people to come into the industry. There's a large staff shortage, but make sure if you can apply yourself, have the right attitude, then there's opportunity out there for everybody.
Attitude, attitude, attitude.
Absolutely, yeah. So with the turbot, as I say, I'm going to cook some nice, large, plump Shetland mussels. I'm just going to season the turbot first, just with some salt. I've got some Maldon sea salt that's been dried out and ground, and just let that sit and season and just...
Is that your favourite salt?
It's a good go-to. It's a good all-rounder. Yeah, we use it extensively throughout the kitchen. And it serves the purpose. There we go. Hi for that. Connor, can you start to prepare some sliced shallots?
Yes, Chef.
And butter mushrooms, just cut in half in nice slices. Maybe two shallots. Three mushrooms. Perfect. So for the mussels, we are going to just steam them off. So these have been, when they come into us in a restaurant, they've got their rope attached to them. We're going to steam them off in some white wine. I've just rinsed these in cold running water and de-bearded. So it's just removing the beard from the mussels into a pan. And I've got some white wine here. We must make sure the pan's nice and smoking hot. And we want a tight fitting lid for this as well. So when the mussels hit the pan, it should be sort of rattling almost. And you want that white wine to react straight away. So white wine on, and they're just going to steam inside themselves. A little bit of a shake and just open up.
So how many 17-year-olds have you got in the kitchen?
Just Connor.
Just Connor?
Just Connor. Just Connor. Connor's the youngest. He's the young buck.
Oh, there we go.
Steaming away. So for the turbot itself, I've got a pan hot. I'm just going to start it off in some oil. It's got normal sort of vegetable oil there. I'm just going to start off on the skin. I've left the skin on just to help protect the fish in the cooking process, but we're not going to serve the skin. Turbot skin's quite thick, it's quite leathery. It's not really an edible skin of the fish. There's lots of skin on fish that you can eat. Turbot's not one of them we would serve. The mussels are steaming nicely.
So what's your go-to dish? What's your favourite dish? If I was to say, what's your favourite fish dish?
Anything cooked simply. If you've got great produce there and you treat it with respect and you've cooked it...
So nothing overtly contrived.
No, I mean more frites. Yeah. It's quite enjoyable. Roast turbot and a good hollandaise sauce chouron sauce would be really enjoyable as well.
And then, of course, you've got this veg garden of yours, so you're spoiled with garniture. And
absolutely, yeah. So I just want to get the turbot started in some oil. The mussels, I don't know if you can see that, have just steamed open. Look at the size of them, they're beautiful. There's nothing better than the fresh mussel just steamed off in some white wine there and eaten from the shell. So I'm going to strain that off and let them sit. And the juice that's collected, obviously that's taken the flavour from the mussel, and the white wine itself, that's going to be form the base of our sauce. Lovely. That's perfect, Connor. Thank you.
No problem.
So to make our sauce, Connor there's just sliced some banana shallots and some white butter mushrooms, a little bit of celery. We're going to sweat that down really nice and soft so it's fondant, releases that nice natural sugariness from the vegetables themselves. Sealing the turbot in some oil, not too hot, we don't want to scorch it. We'll just have a moderate heat that's allowing that natural caramelization.
Just oil itself,
to start with. And just going to build up those flavors and layers of flavors as we go. Again, for the sauce, just start with some oil. Always tend to put oil into the pan first before some butter. It just helps to keep the butter nice and soft and yellow. So we want the vegetables to be nice and white. And we've got our vegetables going in now. So shallots, butter mushrooms, some celery. A pinch of salt as well.
Connor's on the mussels.
And I'll put a lid on. Connor's shelling the mussels. So we're not going to serve the shells today. And the mussels, beautiful and plump. There can tend to be some attachment of the rope left inside, so we need to make sure that they're nice and clean. This is not nice to eat on that. That's good. You can see that?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, so lovely caramelization on the turbot. That's just sealing in all the flavour. As the turbot's cooking in the oil, I'm just using a little bit of oil, just really lightly frying that, sealing that off. But just adding a little bit of oil as I go. Just keeping it nicely basted.
When you're cooking in the restaurant, is this how you would normally do it, or do you do it in a plancha, or you do it?
I cook it in a pan. Absolutely, yeah.
Any questions for Russell?
I'll come down. Well, you serve the dish on the fish on the bone, or do you?
We do, yes.
And how do the customers? How do they cope with that when it comes out?
The customer is sort of taken into that, so. At the time of the order, and you're ordering the chanson, then there's the skill of the front of house team to let them know how to approach the fish, to let them know, obviously, that the fish will be served on the bone as well. It's not always the case that we serve the dish on the bone. It might be for maybe a special du jour. There's quite a rich offering of turbot as well. But it is lovely to cook on the bone. So I think Stephen mentioned before, you know, taking that property of the bone itself in the cooking process will add to the flavour. Mm. I've just put some baking parchment on there.
Below it, yeah. You just pop that.
And I'm going to pop it in the oven.
Gosh, just smelling that, I'm dribbling here like Corky the cat.
So the oven's up high, sort of 220 degrees, and I'm just going to give it 3 minutes. You got time in a minute. Skin side down, again, that just helps protect it. So the vegetables are nice and softened.
So what vegetables have we got in there?
Shallots, butter mushrooms, and celery. Sort of classic aromats for a white fish-based sauce. So Stephen was speaking before about sort of classic velouté. So this is This would be our lighter touch with a velouté. So there is no roux base. We sort of tend to sweat down our vegetables. We've got some aromats there as well. I've got some lovely thyme from the garden. That can go in there.
And noted they're all cut the same size.
By chance, that. Yeah. If you could just juice me some lemons.
See, that's
as well.
Looking good.
Please.
Thank you.
Mussels there, we're just going to keep warm and sweat the thyme into the aromats. So first we're going to do is the mussel liquor. Chinois, where did that go? That's the one, yeah. I'm just going to pass that down. And reduce that onto the vegetables. I want to reduce that as fast as possible to just retain all of the flavour that we've got in there.
And do most of the kitchen staff get to go around each corner? How long do they spend on each corner in the kitchen?
Yeah, I mean, we try to get the staff to rotate as often as possible. It's all on the application of the chefs themselves. To retain consistency within the brigade, you know, there might be someone coming into the kitchen that starts on one section, but then, you know, after a certain length of time, then to move on and progress.
Do you have a couple in the kitchen who just specialise in pastry and they do nothing else? Or
we have a particular pastry chef, yes, that is only pastry.
Okay.
But everyone has the opportunity to work in pastry, yeah, as well. Yeah. I mean, it wasn't always the case. I mean, I've worked in restaurants where it's just a pastry team and the hot kitchen were not welcome, really, into the pastry kitchens.
Yeah, Mr. Mugg.
Okay, all good. So, bringing that mussel juice down, it's got a lovely natural sweetness. We're going to then add our turbot stock. So, I've brought this with me. I've made this last week and frozen it, boiled it out. You can see the gelatinous properties of that stock. It's really strong depth of flavour.
Do you want to out the oven, Chef?
I'll be there in 1 minute, Connor. Oui. I'm just going to add that onto the reduced mussel liquor. Sort of looking for a reduction of about 2/3.
So is that going to be quite? That's going to be quite intense, obviously.
It's going to be full flavoured, yeah, absolutely.
You've just added a belter of a turbot stock to your reduced.
So that's had 3 minutes in the oven now.
Oh.
I'm just going to turn it over. It's a little baste of oil, just to help protect it. And a little grain of salt just to assist the seasoning, build up those layers of flavour. I'm feeling to touch there. I'm looking for firmness from the fish fillet, but a little bit of give as well.
Yep.
With turbot cooking on the bone, like a steak, you really want to let it relax and rest at the end of the cooking process to help finish in the cooking. So another 2 minutes, I feel, on the timer, bringing our turbot stock down. And to garnish this today, 1 pan. That a wee wipe for me, Connor.
Yep.
Please. We're going to do a little fricassee of vegetables and the mussels, which we're going to warm through in some of the mussel liquor and create a sort of natural emulsion. So I've got some samphire, monk's beard, which is really in season at the minute. It's agretti in Italian. It's grown on the salt marshes of Italy. We really like using it this time of year. It's got a really nice natural sort of saline flavour to it, and we're just going to reheat those through with the mussels. Fantastic. Thank you. So just warming the muscles gently in a little bit of the muscle liquor. You can really feel the meatiness of the turbot stock coming through now. But it's nice, there's a balance there. There's acidity from the white wine, the sweetness of the mussels, and then the richness of the turbot. So there's complexity, there's layers of flavour, and a lot of depth, which you'll get. That's our turbot on 2 minutes. That's our turbot back out the oven on 2 minutes. That's had 5 minutes in total in the oven now.
Got that on camera.
And I feel that's really good there to.
Yeah, that looks a belter. Not a culinary term, but.
So the cookery of the turbot's finished now, but I'm just going to baste it with a little bit of butter, again, some aromats, some rosemary, some thyme, some bashed garlic, and just baste it off. A little bit of lemon juice to finish, but no high heat. I use the residual heat of the pan. The butter in there, just foaming around it gently. Again, a fine sprinkle of salt. I'm just basting that over. Thyme and rosemary in there, just gently fried off. That will just start to wilt in that foaming butter. And bashed garlic, good man. Bashed garlic just in the skin, just in there as well. Just let the natural oils of the garlic come out. Turbot sauce, chinois. Chinois back. So the turbot reduction now. We're going to pass it through a chinois. Scraping everything, all the residue out of the pan. Connor, if you can squeeze all of the vegetables out, please.
Re-chef.
Fantastic.
Baste, keep basting, it's great.
And just a drop of lemon juice. Lemon juice is going to stop the butter from going further than you want to. So there is a little bit of nuttiness there. So beurre noisette, a classic term, not brown butter. But the lemon juice has just stopped that from going any further. And there's a natural glaze, a natural emulsion that's created in the pan.
Do you see that on camera?
Good. Okay, good man. So Connor's really squeezed out all of the. That's good. All of the juice from the vegetables. Every last drop squeezed into the pan, so we've extracted as much flavour as possible from that sauce. I just want to reduce that a little bit further. Okay, so the mussels are just reheating and simmering. So I'm going to add in a pinch of the monk's beard. Let that naturally wilt. The samphire as well. So we've just taken the samphire stalks themselves and just picked and washed the tender stems from the top, just like sea asparagus.
So that's two Michelin star, obviously, precision.
Some vegetable, fennel. It's a nice aniseed flavour from the fennel. So we've just taken the outer cheeks of the fennel, bulbs themselves, and just created batons, which we've blanched in boiling salted water and refreshed. It's a nice little vegetable there. And some baby leeks. If you could cut these, just... Come so. Okay. And some baby leeks. I'm going to add some butter to the mussels themselves. And create that nice emulsion. So the turbot stock, reduced, add in some cream, double cream. And we're going to bring that down slightly as well. Thank you. The vegetables all nicely wilted together. A few baby leeks there as well. These have just been blanched and refreshed in ice water. And then we've just finished the sauce and we're almost ready to plate up. Could you just warm that plate in the oven for me, please?
Yep.
Just a minute or so. It's quite a hot oven.
So how many students are competing at Scott Hotter this year? Oh, that's encouraging.
You as well.
All right. Beside the boss, you've got to say yeah.
Almost there. So with the sauce, I'm just going to finish it with a few knobs of butter. And I'm going to blend that in with our hand blender. Tell you what you could do is ask. Have you got a little jug? A little plastic jug? Please. I'm just going to serve this first. So we've emulsified the butter with a Bamex into the sauce. It gives it a lovely, light, frothy texture. And just finish the seasoning on that now. Squeeze the lemon juice. A little bit of salt and pepper. Okay, we're ready to plate up. So with the plate, hot food, hot plate, some vegetables first. We've got the baby leeks there. Some of the nice moles. And then the fricassee of the fennel and the monk's beard around.
So we'll do exactly the same this time when Russell's finished plating up here. We'll do some pictures, so don't go digging in. But Russell will come forward, and I'm sure Cece will as well. Anybody wants to chat to either of them?
Perfect. Yeah, that's perfect. Thank you very much. So with our turbots now rested, one of the really good ways of seeing if this is cooked is just the skin. You should just be able to tease it off without any resistance on both sides. Both sides. Just to finish our turbot, got a little bit of, we call it umami butter. So it's we use it quite a bit in the restaurant just to finish vegetables and meat and fish, roasted fish. And it's just a little bit of Marmite in with some unsalted butter.
Really? Wow.
On top, I've got some more coarser sea salt, which I'm just going to add a few more flakes to. A twist of pepper, and here I've got some dried some dill pollen. So the dill, which we grow in our garden, it pollinates, and we take that pollen, dehydrate it, and make this fine powder with, just to finish little fish with.
So this is straight from the garden.
The dill pollen, yeah. So the turbots. Onto the dishes, so. And I've got my sauce here to serve on the side. And give it another pulse. Create a really lovely, light, frothy texture.
So you take the dill pollen, and then how long do you dry it for?
Overnight, low oven.
Overnight, yeah.
Low oven, set at the lowest temperature possible in the oven. And then we pulverize it with a firmer mix. Pass it for a fine tamis or chinois. So into the, just for to finish the sauce, got some dill oil, which again, we take the green of the herb.
From the garden.
And from the garden. And we dehydrate that as well. And then make an oil, concentrated dill oil with. So that's gonna go into the bottom of the saucing jug, and then the velouté served on top. And there we have it. Tronçon of turbot with monk's beard, mussels, and the velouté made from the stock.
Give him a great big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Wow, amazing.
Thank you.
Ready for my next visit, I tell you.
Fantastic.
That just looks an absolute belter. So, anybody got any questions for Russell? Stick your hand up and I'll get a mic to you. Any questions for Russell? Didn't he be shy, it's the big school though. There we go, got a couple.
What do you grow in the garden?
Sorry?
What else do you grow in the garden? Everything and anything.
A copious amount of baby vegetables, micro herbs, flowers, edible flowers, oyster leaf. We grew artichokes last year for the first time. We don't grow large vegetables, like carrots, onions, we still buy that, but 95% of our produce in the main season is coming from the garden. So every week, the chefs would go down and speak to. It's not on the grounds of the hotel, the restaurant. It's in between the restaurant and Perth. But we go down on regular visits with the gardening team and really devise our menus from there. What's upcoming? Plan on a yearly basis of when things are going to be available for the year. It's not much in February. Granted, but there's a preserving process throughout the year that allows us to continue the flavour of the garden throughout the restaurant in the winter months.
Yeah.
But we grow lots and lots of things, yeah. It's a wonderful produce to work with, it really is.
Mike coming. Well, Ellie coming, actually, there's the mic.
How long from development to the dish gets to the table, Russell?
With new dishes, we tend to, with the menu, we tend to have mainstays on the menu. We try and celebrate the larder of Scotland, you know, throughout every dish. So there's always scallops, the best lamb, turbot, lobster, etc. But it's really tweaking and using the garden throughout the season to enhance the main proteins of the dish. So there's more tweaks on a daily basis rather than wholesale changes. But you'll see colour change throughout the year as with the seasons.
Anybody else got a question?
Okay. Anybody got a question for Cece? Any of the students, apprentices, got a question for Cece? A lot of why we're here. Eh? Oh, want to be chefs? No questions? Or you're all too shy? A bit like me when I was your age. Oh, there you go. There you go.
Do you have any tips on, you know, the best way to reach out to chefs if you're interested in even a stage or anything like that?
Absolutely.
You know, best timings to do so of the day, you know, or even of the year if they're like, if they've got a long backlog for stages and stuff like that.
There isn't a huge backlog of stages. You know, I think one of the frightening things in the industry is we are all looking for good staff, regardless of whether you're of restaurant Andrew Fairley or Glen Eagles Hotel. Everyone's looking for staff throughout the industry, you know. So the best way is just to really compose your CV in the best way. Reach out via email. Most restaurants, hotels have got really good careers pages. Look at the websites, go onto their careers pages, have a look at the menu, understand the product, understand the restaurants, the hotels, the history behind them, what type of food they are, what style of working conditions are, and then put yourself forward in your best way possible. Make sure your CV's right, and make sure your email's polite and forthcoming, and, you know, as I say, attitude is everything, you know.
Okay, perfect, thank you.
No problem.
Anybody else got a question?
This one's for Cece. What? Why did you choose to go in the catering career?
Well, my dad's a chef. He's been a chef since I was growing up. Even as like a young lad, I was cooking. But eventually it came to me. I was about 14. I went for a day's work experience in this place called Johnston's of Elgin. Loved every second of it. It was just prep, prep, prep. And that led me to go to college, which was Murray College. And that led to me just wanting more non-stop. It'd be after college, I'd go into work. I would work 6 days a week usually, only one day to sort of myself. But it's just I wanted to keep going, get more, you know?
Passion, there you go. You've got to have it, drive.
Thanks very much, well done.